Recently, SpaceX won a $150 million contract to launch satellites for Space Development Agency. The contract is to launch a mix of small and medium spacecraft of different sizes that the Space Development Agency is acquiring from multiple vendors. It includes 20 data relay satellites known as the transport layer, and the other 8 are missile warning satellites known as the tracking layer. SpaceX will launch the satellites on 2 Falcon 9 rockets in the 7 months between September 2022 and March 2023. If things go according to plan, those 2 launches will orbit the Earth as a part of the Tranche 0 satellite constellation. The manifest will be divided into 2 planes of 14 spacecraft, each in 2 circular near-polar orbits, at an altitude of 950 kilometers. The mission will provide the U.S. military with a globally networked satellite constellation of communications satellites and missile detection satellites, capable of delivering warning, tracking, and targeting data anywhere on Earth. SpaceX will launch these satellites from Vandenberg Air Force Base, California. China and Russia independently launched 2 top-secret satellites last week. China launched its Yagan-33 satellite from Jiuquan Satellite Launch Center atop a Long March 4 rocket on December 27. Chinese media described the satellite as intended for scientific experiments, land survey, crop yield assessment, and disaster monitoring. But experts suspect that they are also used for military purposes. The satellite is believed to have used optical or synthetic aperture radar sensors for Earth observation. On 29 December, a Soyuz STA rocket lifted off from French Guiana, carrying the CSO-2 Earth observation satellite for the French Ministry of Defense. The CSO-2 satellite is the second of 3 new generation high-resolution optical imaging satellites for the French military, replacing the Helios 2 spy satellite series. Built by Airbus and Thales Alenia Space, the satellite provides extremely high-resolution imagery, with a spatial resolution of 20 centimeters from a 480 kilometers orbit. With a total launch mass of 3,562 kilograms and a design life of 10 years, the satellite will operate in an orbit inclined 97.3 degrees to the equator. Once become fully operational, the CSO satellite constellation will gather global intelligence and strategic surveillance, gain knowledge of the geographical environment, and support operational deployments. The White House released a national strategy for planetary protection on December 30, outlining new assessments to prevent terrestrial contamination of other worlds and Earth. The National Strategy for Planetary Protection, developed by an interagency working group, outlines work to be done over the next year to update planetary protection policies, considering both scientific advances as well as growing private capabilities in space exploration. The 3 main objectives of planetary protection strategy are avoiding harmful forward contamination or contamination of other worlds by terrestrial life, by developing and implementing risk assessments, science-based guidelines, and updating the interagency payload review process. Avoiding backward contamination or potential contamination of the Earth by any extraterrestrial life, with a restricted sample return program. Developing guidelines for authorization and continuing supervision of private sector missions to destinations with planetary protection implications, in particular, Mars. The strategy does not set any new policy, but instead outlines work on various issues to be done over the next year. The expansion of our universe is accelerating over time, and no one is sure why. Astrophysicists have proposed all kinds of theories for what the missing piece might be, and many of these rely on changing the way gravity works over large scales. A new paper co-authored by a University of Chicago scientist lays out a new technique to tackle this problem through gravitational wave observations. A theory refers to the existence of an extra particle that explains the rapid expansion of the universe. Such a particle generates a kind of background or medium around large objects. If a traveling gravitational wave hit a supermassive black hole, it would generate waves that would get mixed up with the gravitational wave itself. Depending on what it encountered, the gravitational wave signature could carry an echo. The paper lays out the conditions for how to find such echoes in future data. The Gravitational Waves Observatory, LIGO, is scheduled to begin its next set of observations in 2022, with an upgrade to make the detectors even more sensitive than they already are. This would help the researchers to see as many as hundreds of events per year. The research team hopes that the increased numbers make it more likely that one or more waves will have traveled through a massive object and that scientists will be able to analyze them for clues to the missing components. an Indian rocket launch startup, Skyroot Aerospace, announced a successful test firing of its solid propulsion rocket stage, named Kalam-5, on December 29. Kalam-5 is a demonstrator solid rocket propulsion stage, with the same propellant, materials, and interfaces as the three solid propulsion stages of the company's Vikram-1 launch vehicle. It gives a peak sea-level thrust of 5.3 kilonewtons and is designed to take 66 atmospheres and 30,000 degrees Celsius of combustion pressure and temperature. The Skyroot Aerospace's solid propulsion rocket stage has been built with an advanced carbon composite structure, which is 5 times lighter than steel. This is a completely automated process and indigenous production. The firm even mentioned that Kalam-5 is the first of 5 Kalam series of solid rocket motors, while the rest 4 are expected to be tested next year. Kalam-5 uses 15 different types of advanced materials and has 9 manufacturing processes, with 0 moving parts. Skyroot is planning to build a family of Vikram series rockets, and with the help of ISRO, their first vehicle is expected to be launched in December 2021. The Vikram series consists of 3 launch vehicles, developed especially to launching small satellites for ISRO and other space research organizations. NASA has approved 2 heliophysics missions to explore the Sun and the system that drives space weather near Earth. The missions are named the Extreme Ultraviolet High Throughput Spectroscopic Telescope Epsilon mission and the Electrojet Zeeman Imaging Explorer. Together, NASA's contribution to the missions will help us understand the Sun and Earth as an interconnected system. Targeted for launch in 2026, EUVEST is a solar telescope that will study how the solar atmosphere releases solar wind and drives eruptions of solar material. These phenomena propagate out from the Sun and influence the space radiation environment throughout the solar system. The Japan Aerospace Exploration Agency leads this mission, along with other international partners. The Electrojet Zeeman Imaging Explorer will study electric currents in Earth's atmosphere, linking aurora to the Earth's magnetosphere. The mission will launch no earlier than June 2024. The combined budget for these 2 missions is $108 million. Now, let's discuss the major Starship updates from the past week. 1 week after the rocket was rolled from the factory to the launch pad, SpaceX appears to have successfully put Starship Serial No. 9 through 2 routine pre-launch tests. On December 28, Serial No. 9 undergone an ambient temperature pressure test, filling the propellant tanks with nitrogen gas at atmospheric temperature. The test was intended to check for leaks, verify basic vehicle valve and plumbing performance, and ensure a basic level of structural integrity. The very next day, SpaceX conducted a cryo-proof test of Serial No. 9. The exterior of Starship SN9 began to develop a coating of frost after SpaceX started loading its oxygen and methane tanks with liquid nitrogen. The cryo-proof test ensures that Starship can safely load, hold, and offload supercool liquids. It appears that the liquid oxygen header tank of the Starship wasn't filled during the test. SpaceX will either conduct a cryo-proof test involving the header tank or move directly to a static fire test this week. In a recent public notice, Cameron County ordered to temporarily close State Highway 4 and Boca Chica Beach from January 4 to 6. SpaceX will conduct the next round of tests during these days. SpaceX CEO Elon Musk recently announced that Starship Super Heavy boosters could fully forego landings and instead execute a catch and quick release approach to secure the spacecraft. Previously, SpaceX planned to retrieve Super Heavy boosters in the same manner as Falcon 9, either landing them on an ocean-based platform or returning to touchdown as near as possible to the launch site. Elon Musk also maintained a consistent willingness to land Super Heavy boosters right at the top of the launch mount. In a recent tweet, Musk says that SpaceX might be able to catch Super Heavy in mid-air with the launch tower arm, using the stainless steel grid fins to take the load. Although such a solution sounds about as complex and risky, this approach would not only save money and mass by removing the need for the booster to have landing legs, but also allow it to be immediately repositioned onto the launch mount for reuse. Musk added that this would allow the booster to be ready to refly in under an hour. This new approach requires SpaceX to redesign the grid fins and launch tower to capture the booster and handle its weight. Starship Serial No. 10 received its nose cone section on Saturday. A crane lifted the nose cone and placed it atop the thrust section of SN10 inside the high bay, completing the prototype assembly. SN10 is now ready to be rolled out to launch pad A. If SpaceX managed to roll out SN10 to the launch site before the flight of SN9, we will be able to witness two Starship prototypes standing close to each other at the launch site soon. Now, let's take a look at the current status of various Starship prototypes. Serial number 11 got stacked to the usual full level last week. After the nose cone got mated with the barrel section, the entire structure will be lifted and placed atop SN11, completing the prototype assembly. Serial number 12, standing next to SN11 inside the midbay, got its aft dome and engine sections assembled. SpaceX will stack the remaining sections in the coming weeks. The methane header tank and forward dome section of serial number 13 are lying on the construction site, waiting for the remaining sections. SpaceX completed the production of the engine skirt, downcomer, and nose cone section of serial number 14. SpaceX also completed the construction of the nose cone barrel section, oxygen tank midsection, common dome and aft dome sections of Starship serial number 15. According to Elon Musk, SN15 will be the first Starship prototype to receive major upgrades. As per the latest reports, the construction of the common dome of serial number 16 and aft dome sleeve of serial number 17 were completed. Currently, booster BN1 is under construction inside the high bay. In a recent tweet, Mr. Musk stated that the first hop of Super Heavy prototype likely would happen in a few months. With this, we have covered all the major updates from last week. Please share your thoughts on the latest science news and Starship updates in the comments section. Also, do not forget to subscribe to the channel for more weekly updates. And as always, thanks for watching.